What's up, everybody? It is your sis and your friend Crystal Cross right here on the Morning Jam, the evening edition. I'm so glad and excited to be here with the one and only, you guys, Palmer Williams. What's up?
Doing good. How about you?
I'm doing great. It is so excited to have you here on my show. I know that we've met a couple of times.
Right.
At an event in Atlanta here.
Yes. Georgia Entertainment Gala.
Yeah, it was. Like, yeah, that. And then it was on the Experience on Demand with Dominique Mitchell.
Yes.
You were hosting that event. That was, what, 3 years ago, maybe? Close to 3 years.
They're all running together now.
Yeah, they're all running together. So how's it been?
Been real good. Been real good. Coming out of this COVID so-called quarantine, I don't know. Everybody didn't get the memo on the quarantine because people have been wilding out.
They have been wilding out.
And then everybody on 285 has been driving like they've lost their mind. So, you know, and I've already shared that with you off camera. But, in the midst of all of this, in the midst of all the trouble and turmoil, I can yet say I'm blessed.
Well, good. Yeah. I can say the same.
Exactly.
I can say that I'm blessed. Yeah, we're here. And a lot of my family member back in Arkansas. So A2, what's up, you guys? I love y'all.
A2.
A2. This is A1, I hear.
Oh, okay. Atlanta and then Arkansas. Maybe Alabama is number one, then Arkansas is two. I don't know.
Oh, see?
There it is.
We can put Atlanta on number three.
I'm straight out of Bama.
Well, cool. But I know for a lot of my friends back in Arkansas that they've had family members that passed from the COVID. So I've definitely experienced that kind of close up on hand, but not really in my family. Just truly blessed that none of my family members have not even caught it or anything like that. So how is it for you being staying at home, locked in? What you do?
Never was locked in.
No,
so actually, I have a landscape business, so I've been out the whole time.
Just for now.
Yeah, but until they tell me that, you know, Bermuda grass has the coronavirus, you know, we yet have to cut it. So, that's been that one thing. So it has been some sustainability, especially with the entertainment industry, you know, pretty much being on shutdown until like right now.
Well, that's awesome. So nothing for you have just slowed down. Everything's been...
No, it hasn't. Actually, at one point, I became a little bit concerned because I got sick and I had a sinus infection. But, you know, all of the symptoms of a sinus infection are the same as that of a coronavirus, COVID-19. And so I was a little concerned. It put me down for 5 straight days.
Wow.
Until I went to the doctor and found out I didn't have it. So I was, like, relieved. But still, you know, recovering from that, you can hear a little scratchy voice and all that kind of stuff. But it was just amazing that... it was a much needed rest.
Yeah, so they actually tested you for COVID-19. Yes. And I know I'm in the medical field, kind of over the front office, but I know how they do test you for the COVID-19, and that's not fun at all.
This nostrils right here. It's a whole nother thing.
That, you know.
Oh, my goodness.
Plenty of room to.
Unfortunately, I've already been used to having a test of my sinus and nasal cavity and stuff like that, because being a singer and then going to the eye, ear, nose, and throat, you know, doctor and stuff like that, and even having a scope of my vocal cords, having to stick the tube through your nostrils down to your throat, you know, and trying not to gag. So, you know, those are things that that I've been kind of used to doing that. It's never comfortable, but... something that's necessary to make sure of your health.
For you to say that, I'm a singer too, and I've never had that done.
Oh, you should. You should always know the status of your vocal cords.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Eye, ear, nose, and throat. Go straight through your nostrils, scope it, go right down to your throat.
I don't know if I can handle
that. And you almost have to say, ah, the whole time you're doing it.
Palmer, I don't know if I can handle
that. Yes, you can.
I would probably just throw it right on the
sink. If you can sing when you're hoarse and you had to push through, then you can do that.
Okay, I've done that then. Yeah. So
you ever been choked at the pool? Like you drank the water the wrong way?
Yes.
You can do this.
I'm good. Okay. All right.
You can do this.
Well, good.
It's a similar sensation, but you know, not quite as bad.
Absolutely.
Because you're not splashing all the water and beating up the doctor during that process. So.
Yeah, we can't be doing that.
Right.
We gotta
have
them take care of us.
Exactly.
So in the midst of all the COVID-19, we do have the pandemic that's going on with the, you know, the COVID-19, and then we have the George Floyd.
That's another form of a pandemic.
Yeah.
Instead of it being something that they want us to be quarantined, they want to kind of suppress us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those that are protesting. And most of my protests come from the polls. has come from supporting others financially
yeah.
in their quest to go out there. Even my own daughter actually participated in the protests that were here, participated in a legal manner. And so, you know, no destruction or anything like that. And I was very apprehensive about her going, as a matter of fact, you know, a parental safety mindset, you know, because I know that this is a different type of protest from the days in which, you know, my parents were protesting and, you know, even myself, you know, at latter parts of lesser, you know, issues. But it's a different world we live in now.
And
the tolerance level is very low from those that are in power and also those that are in an authoritative position.
Yeah.
So you have to be very careful about, you know, pretty much choosing your battles. And you have to understand that when you're in a protest, you're standing next to a total stranger and you don't know their intent. So there are other ways in which we can really, really, if you want to really fight a battle, support black business. Not only that, stop buying where people don't like you.
Yeah.
You know, there's an OK Cafe that just took down a rebel flag that was historically there for a number of years. And yet and still, we know that that particular symbol represents a history of hate.
Yeah.
And so with that, you know, they actually took it down just recently because of social media saying like, hey, don't patronize the store. No, don't be a patron of this store if they're going to have a representation of oppression, hate, murder, you know, and things like that on your wall. So that means that, you know, you're just that arrogant that you want our money, but you don't want to take down that symbol of hate.
Exactly. I'm actually, you know, like I said, from Arkansas, and you talked about the flag. There's so many flags like that. Even growing up as a little girl, I remember seeing the flags and my mom teaching me about the flag. So in Arkansas, there's multiple, you know, places where you'll go. I remember riding with one of my white friends and she was like, oh, you know, all that stuff is over with. I said, where have you been living under a rock? What is really? So we were taking a trip with her. I was taking a trip with her and we was going to her brother's house that was out and, you know, backwoods. So I said, now, you sure I need to go back this far with you?
Well, you know, that's usually the black concern.
Yeah.
You do with a white person, you all of a sudden, you know, you did see, what was the movie? This Is Us or something. The one with Peele.
Get out.
She took him to the home to meet the parents.
Yeah, so I was going and I was like, racism is
Yeah, there's always, we think we're going to take us back in the back of the woods and we'll just roll up on a Klan meeting or something like that. That used to be the little running joke I used to say all the time in Alabama, but the issue is that, you know, if you're not careful, you can't run up on one.
Yeah, and because, the thing was, you know, was really crazy about that, Palmer, was about time she said that, we rolled up on the ground on the highway, what we were on, said, stop, KKK, on the ground. I said, look, see, I just told you that, now take me back.
Right, right.
You know, me being young, I was like,
just
let's,
not knowing,
let's,
you know,
get out
And they're
here.
Saying that, you know, that is over and stuff like that. Now, one thing for sure, it is over, because that basically should be a symbol of that you lost.
Yeah.
That was the battle flag of the ones who lost. So how is it that you're trying to celebrate the history of the biggest loss you ever had in your life?
Right.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Yes.
And then it took a white governor that painted a picture like he was for them to get into office in Georgia to take the actual Confederate stars and bars, as they call it, off of the Georgia state flag. So we actually, just until within the last 8 years, had that flag removed from the capital of Georgia.
That's crazy.
Right.
And I was actually sending G. Wade a post of the video of George Floyd, and they showed a clip and they said, it didn't show this part, but it drew up to the guys, the cops, you know, his little mic thing where he reached and turned it down. And I was like, I didn't pay attention to the shades not moving on his head or anything, because it was more on, everything was pointing toward
focus
everybody.
On him.
Yeah, so nobody paid attention really to, they were really focused on the life of George and, you know, the cop and his knee being pressed. So it's really crazy out here. So I have worries as a mom. I have a 17-year-old black young man.
Right,
so I have a worry.
17?
Yeah.
Wow. You must have had them when you were two.
No.
Okay.
I was in my 20s.
That's funny.
I'm 38. I don't mind telling
my
age.
Oh, wow, wow.
I'm 38.
You know, you look great.
I'm holding at 30,
yeah,
though.
That's what you call. 30. Well, I've been basically representing 50 for about 5 years now.
That's
yeah,
good.
Yeah, yeah. I have a continual anniversary of my 50th birthday party. So.
Listen, they say the 50s are the new 40s.
They really are, because, and you definitely got to stay in shape with it, too, because... This day and time now, and then I got teenagers, and so I'm like, you know, I gotta be ready, you know, in case one of you know jump me or something like that.
We don't want that. Mm-hmm. What you gonna do?
I just lost 20 pounds too. They think they can they can rough me up, but I still outweigh them. So
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So how are your kids handling the quarantine and stuff?
Surprisingly, we haven't killed each other. It's an interesting animal. My oldest daughter has been home since March from FAMU. And then we have my two sons that have been home since about late March when Cobb County decided, you know, everybody's not going back to school and everything. Mm-hmm. And I think we've been doing pretty good. Actually, I'm sort of relieved because the comings and goings are not as frequent. And I'm able to have less anxiety about my black son driving his black little brother or his sister driving out. And I'm constantly wondering, you know, was the time that I saw them walk out the door be the last time? And I don't want that anxiety. I don't want that type of concern. And I think that's the fear that those that are in power want us to have, because with fear you can control people's actions. They're afraid to do anything other than what you say. So you know, I have to do a lot of praying, a lot of soul searching, contemplating some CBD oil and some other things to help ease the nerves,
ease
you know,
nerve.
By way of Grand Marnier and Uncle Nearest whiskey. So, you know, I just look at the bottle. I didn't say I was drinking it for all my church members out there. But no, it's one of those things where you have to let it go and let God and pray that whatever you taught your children, it will stick and that they can bring it up in their recall memory in the event that they need it when they're in a tight position.
Yeah.
And prayerfully they're making, you know, the right, correct choices.
Yeah. Well, that's good. So we're going to go ahead and just go on past this. We're going to go back, take it back just a little bit.
I'm listening.
Let us know about Palmer Williams. Let's start from the beginning.
You don't have that much time.
Well, just give us a little.
You don't have a pillow and a blanket and everything else. Lay down and tell you like a therapist. You're asking me these questions and it may bring up some mental illness.
We don't want that.
And that's another thing about we as a people, we got to understand that mental illness is a real thing.
That's true.
And I don't think we realize it, and I don't think the rest of the world realizes that right now, the entire black population is suffering from PTSD. You know, because this is a post-traumatic stress disorder that we're going through because of George Floyd and the many others that have lost their lives, you know, unnecessarily. But as far as myself, I'm born and raised out of Camden, Alabama, by way of Mobile, Alabama. And eventually went from the humble beginnings of being this young kid that my mom wanted me to sing. And, you know, she found that I could sing at the time and kind of nurtured that gift a little bit, you know, because she had gone through Knoxville College, which I eventually, you know, went to Knoxville College as well, because that's where she met my father and they got married shortly after graduation. And with that, the spark was lit in myself. And I continued on to, you know, work with music, and finally my mother was... wanted me to sing, and it was at a funeral. So I was a little afraid because I had to stand by the casket.
Yeah.
Needless to say that I know that the next funeral that I would attend would be hers.
Oh, wow.
So I was really, really devastated with that. So from henceforth, I, you know, dedicate my performances to her. And as time went on and I moved in with my aunt until my father was able to, you know, recover from that, and he got remarried about 7 years later.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, you know, went back to my hometown of Camden after living with my aunt and uncle down in Mobile, Alabama. And then after high school, went on to Knoxville College, partial scholarship with choir, musical performance, but my degree is in health and hospital administration, minor in biology and math. I wanted to be a dentist. Go figure.
Yeah.
So all that went down, and finally got to a point where I started venturing out, did a short stint with the Navy, didn't like that, got out, went straight to the Apollo. Started singing at the Apollo, won a couple of local championships and all that kind of stuff, and then I went on a national one and got like second place in that one. And so I was like, this is what I gotta do. I've been trying to deny my gifts.
Yeah.
So I went ahead and pursued that, got involved with a local theater company in Knoxville, Tennessee called Carpetbag Theater. And sort of cut my teeth with them as well, mm-hmm. as well as the influence of my choir director, Miss Ruth B. Stokes, God rest her soul. She really influenced me quite a bit in the performance arts.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that, started doing plays. I did Good Man is Hard to Find, which was a gospel play that toured for 3.5 years, and cut my teeth on the theater realm of things. Had never done musical theater like that, you mm-hmm. know, other than in college. But actually being paid for it, I was like, whoa, this is pretty cool.
Pretty
so,
cool, huh?
Yeah. Then Dad went on to do a lot of background work with Keith Sweat, Monica, and LSG. Did a little small performance with Journey while we were in college and stuff like that. That was very exciting when they were like really huge and they needed a little black choir from across the way.
Yeah.
So all of these things led to going forward and starting a family.
Yeah.
Then eventually getting a chance performance at New Birth where I actually played Jesus trying to protect this girl. And it was a reenactment of another particular performance. And we sort of, I guess you could say, blackened it. And so we did our own performance of it. And then just so happened that Tyler Perry was there that day. And he had somebody from his office to call the church to get my number, and that person called me. The casting director said, you have 2 chances for an audition tomorrow at 11 or 1. Which one do you want?
Mm-hmm.
Say 11. So 10:15 that morning, I was in the parking lot, snotting, crying, and praying. Like, Lord, if you make me a good steward over this man's work, I'm sure you're going to make me Lord over my own. And
wow.
I went in there, 15-minute audition turned into 2 hours. And 6 days later, I was shooting House of Pain.
Wow, that is so awesome.
Yeah.
So let's go back for just a minute. You were a drama minister.
Yes, yes.
So how was that for you?
So you've been all in my business, all on the internet. I'm going to go back there and see what they're saying about me.
How was that for you and being a drummer and drama at that?
No, drama, actually.
Oh, drama.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But while I was in college, I was a drummer. Yeah.
Okay.
So I was in college. I was in a marching band. Yeah, yeah, that was my thing. That drumline thing, know all about that. That was for real. just wasn't. And then what's even crazier is that we came down from Knoxville and we played Morehouse.
Oh,
and
okay.
Our school is way smaller than Morehouse. And, you know, they were clowning us and talking about our band size. It was so small. They said, what is this, a sectional? It was hilarious. And I had to keep from laughing because we were already kind of hot because we were losing.
Right.
So we went out there. And I mean, I'm about to date myself, Facebook. Look here. we went out there. And the big song at the time was, when we got out there, we said, Morehouse, have you heard? There's a brand new dance called The Bird. You know how old that is?
I don't even know what that
and
is.
And we
I'm
did
sorry.
The Bird. That's exactly. So if you look up The Bird by the time.
I will.
You'll understand that I was 19 years old out there playing the drums. And we did that. And the crowd booed Morehouse Band after we performed because we killed them.
Wow.
And then what did we do that for? Football team came back and won the game. I remember I can still see myself busting my drum head because we were so excited. And we had to hurry up and get up out of there before they started trying to fight us. The band wanted to fight us. Now, you were outnumbered. It was like the movie 300.
Oh, not 300 now.
But we was more like 30. So, yeah, it was... That's one of my college experiences with that, with band. But as far as the drama ministry at New Birth,
mm-hmm.
Bishop Eddie Long, God rest his soul, he really had a lot of faith in me. And but this was what was so crazy. He didn't really know me. So what I did is I put together a presentation, and I took one of his sermons that I was sitting in the congregation and listening to,
mm-hmm.
and it just was so powerful. It was basically the story of Samson and Delilah, but he put it in a way that was very palatable, very, very current, very, very powerful in the sense that, you know, you really could relate to maybe some of the things about it.
Yeah.
And so in sitting there thinking about that, I put together a presentation, I guess what would be known as a pitch back then, and I pitched it to him, and it was so funny because he was just sitting there, he was talking to me like this, kept feeling his desk, just answering, you know, yeah, this real nice, real deep voice like this.
Did that make you nervous?
Oh, I was terrified. And at the time, my manager was Montel Jordan and his wife, Kristen. So she was with me. So, you know, he's like, you know, going in the door here. No, right.
Wow.
And I was thinking, like, he is really blowing me off right now. He's not paying attention. Then he's like, you know, we had all the paperwork in front of him. We had bullet points because I had been coached on how I should approach it, right, from some of his staff. It's like, Vanessa, you know where my checkbook is. It's like, and she told him, it's like, and made that lower drawer, such, such, such. So I reached down there, and he was talking to me. Just kept doing that, right? And then he ripped it out. He's like, you know I trust you.
Oh, wow.
He wrote me a $75,000 check.
Wow. You know I trust you, and slid it.
That's when this happened. I was like, wow.
Okay,
you had me at $75,000.
So you need to take yours out and write the $75,000 and slide it over here and say, you know I trust you.
Right. Yeah, I can write it. You may not be able to cash it, but I can write it.
It's going to bounce right
back. You know what I'm saying? I'll put down there Crystal CrossFit and see if you can cash that, you
exactly.
babe.
Exactly.
But, yeah, it was... It was amazing. So that started the wheels of doing my own touring show.
Mm-hmm.
And I can proudly say that I was one of the few people that paid him back.
Because
a lot of people had borrowed money or invested with him and everything. And he lost a lot of money from people that just, you know, that he thought he could trust. Because I remember paying him back some of the extra after the 75 because I still blessed him with money afterwards. And he said, you know, this makes me very happy because nobody pays me back. And so that was the legacy.
Do you think that always happened to the good-hearted people?
Yeah.
It always happens.
And what can happen is that it's a reason for it. You can learn what not to do. And you can also get in a position to where you use discernment and you start thinking a little bit more wisely and choosing the people that you choose to work with. And you have to make sure that it's something that God has appointed for you to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Because if you're just doing it for the money, then it won't come, not naturally, and it won't come organically. And it may not come in the way that you want it to come, which is legally, too.
Yeah.
So, you know, you have to really, really, really pray over these decisions that you may make in business because you can really, really be taken. You know, if I had all the money that I've loaned out right now, I'd be in pretty good shape.
What?
You know,
wow.
But the thing is that I know that I gave it with the intent for it to be something good and something to come good of it and to support my family. But I feel sorry for those who crossed me. I'm not using your name.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel sorry for those who crossed me because most of the people that have ever crossed me financially are not doing well now.
Wow.
So there are a few people out there now that I don't wish bad on them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to get them back.
Right.
My father will.
Yeah, exactly.
So you just have to pray. That's what they mean by praying for your enemies.
Because
God can destroy your enemies if you're not. You just have to just turn your head. Because if he tells you, just like, close your eyes, or turn your head.
The thing is, Palmer, you just said a powerful thing now. Turn your head.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we talked about earlier when you was driving in here.
Yeah. I wasn't about to turn my head to that silly girl that almost hit me on 285 with the Texas tags. She should be going on probably 85 South by now. It's a gray Chevrolet Malibu.
All the information
out. It's about a 2018-19, somewhere in there.
Good Lord.
And she's wearing a mask. And the guy in the back seat left is wearing a mask. Same color mask.
I'm sorry, young lady. I'm truly sorry.
I hope she reads this because you know what? I can get lawyered up.
We don't want that. We don't want it to go that far.
No, I'm saying if she had hit me.
Yeah, we got to get, you know, turned the other cheek.
That's why I pray before I leave anywhere when I leave the house.
So let's get on. You were talking about meeting Tyler Perry and just coming and He said that 15 minutes turned into 2 hours for you.
Well, he's never on the audition.
Never.
Mm-hmm. We taped the audition and everything. He wasn't there. It was the casting director and Mr. Ruben Cannon. And the casting director at the time was Miss Alpha Tyler, mm-hmm. Who is a professor at SCAD. So that was the first connect with Tyler Perry Studios, even though I'd known Tyler before. But in a working capacity, this was like the first time. And the next time was I saw him was actually when I showed up on set.
Thanks.
It was time to go to work.
That's dope.
Just like that. So it was 6 episodes turning into 42.
Mm-hmm.
And then after those 42, it turned into the Marriage Counselor tour, Laugh to Keep from Crying.
Tons more.
If Loving You is Wrong.
Tons Madea's
more. Madea's Big Happy Family.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can, yeah, there's a few of them. Mm-hmm. There's 6 of them, I think.
And then that was the newest, Little, where you played the part
oh,
of...
Oh, wow. Yeah, that was...
Somebody come get this black woman. BMW.
Yeah, people come up to me in Walmart talking about BMW. The funny part about that was is that I was at my daughter's orientation at FAMU.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a call from a casting director, said they forgot to cast this one particular part, and said, would I do it? I said, sure, when is it? He said, tomorrow. I said, oh, wow, I'm in Florida. I said, okay, what time is call time? He said, 8 o'clock. I said, okay. Left my family down there, rented a car from Tallahassee, Florida, drove back that night, and then did that at 8 o'clock in the morning, took all the way up until 8 o'clock the next night. And then after I did that, I returned the car back down to Florida and rejoined my family and then drove back.
Wow.
So I drove down, drove back, drove down, drove back in a matter of 3 days and did that part. There was no lines. I made those lines up.
That's dope.
Because the director says, like, hey, I know you. I like your work. I said, well, I like your work, too. You know, not to mention she was a pretty lady. So I was like, I like your work, too. So anyway, so she's a... Say what?
Give me the
oil. I know, right? You got to pray for me. So here was... they had a break and they had to reset some cameras or something. So she came over to me because I'm just pacing back and forth, you know, doing the microphone thing, you know, trying to be security guard. Because I actually used to work security for Sears in Knoxville, Tennessee, and when I was in college, another whole story. So with that being said, she came over and was like, what would you say if something like this was happening? Just kind of tell me, what would you say? She's almost like she was interviewing me. I said, well, I'd see this black woman meeting this black child. I said, oh, God. You know, you might want to call the police because it's not going to be pretty at all. It's like, and then plus she was driving a BMW, one of the sports car, right? I said, and it's just like, it was a comedy anointing. And I said, BMW, black mama whooping, just like that. And she busted out laughing. She's like, get some cameras over here. Get some cameras right now. He's like, oh my God, BMW, black mama whooping. She's still laughing on the way back over there. Came over there. And mind you, it was East Hail hot. It was about 90 degrees that day in that hot uniform. And so eventually got to, she actually put the cameras on me. Shot for about an hour just for that one line, those 2-3 lines. And my reactions and all that like stuff like that. And the way they painted it. And then kudos to her for putting me in the movie. And I appreciate that because I didn't get on the editing room floor for one. And for Will Packer to put me in the trailer. That was monumental, you know, for career purposes and just for visual. And for people to see me doing something other than a Tyler Perry production also. And then shout outs to George Pierre that, you know, by texting me and thinking of me in the event that he needed somebody to fill in that would be willing to do it. And he said one of the things that he did appreciate is that I didn't whine and complain about the fact that I had to drive back. He didn't even know I was in Florida. And I wasn't going to tell him till afterwards. Because I didn't want to give it to nobody else.
Nobody else.
Mind you, it was just a decent day rate, but hey.
Yeah.
Now it's on HBO.
Exactly. So how was it working for Regina Hall was in it, right?
Oh, yeah. I didn't know she was that tiny, but she's tiny but powerful, you know, and nice.
She's one of my fave actresses.
She's real nice. She's laid back. you know, she may be on her phone, or she may be reading something, whatever, but she was just real laid back. She was in a robe most of the time while we were there, but, you know, just real cool people.
Mm-hmm.
Her, Issa Rae, all of them just kind of chilled. And I think at that point, they had been shooting for quite some time. So they bought over this. So they were maybe tired or whatever, but just everybody was real chill. And then it rained that day.
Mm.
So we had to stop.
So and that made it hotter.
We ended up shooting basketball in the school gym. So we were there. I'm in full uniform.
Trying
not to get funky. You know, because we still got to shoot. This is prior to the lines being given.
Wow.
Yeah. And then they had to produce sunlight because it was getting later in the day and we were losing sunlight. The lights they use, oh my goodness. Yeah, those cans they use and on cranes and stuff like that. And there was one of the cranes that they actually had painted completely black. You know, so this wasn't no rental crane. You know, so, it was just, the production was amazing. You can tell that Will Power Packer knows his business, and that's why he's so highly successful, because he spares no expense to make sure everything is captured as it should be, and trusting the director and trusting the actors and things like that. That's a whole nother world that goes on that people don't see. That actually, you know, creates the magic of what we know as movie making and
mm-hmm.
TV.
Mm-hmm.
So people have to understand, you don't always have to be in front of the camera. You know, there's a lot of careers behind the camera and the whole staffing and the whole production. It's an amazing animal, because one thing that made me think about that is that the stagehands at the Beacon Theater back in 1992 were making six figures there at that place. When I was thinking to myself, I'm an actor and I'm not making six mm-hmm. figures. But there was this one guy, he was almost retired. All he had to do is go out there and put the light on the stage when it was a dark stage, when people were not supposed to get on, and take it off. That was his job
wow.
the whole day.
Wow.
Six figures.
So
in New York.
Let's do something fun right quick,
I'm
Palmer.
Listening. As okay, I take
so
another sip of my
you
drink.
Take another sip right quick, and we're going to do just a little small skit.
Oh,
you're going
to
teach me something real quick, okay?
I didn't know I was going to work today.
Yeah, we're going to go to work today. Just a little bit. So we're going to play.
Don't forget, I'm going to need your email for the invoice.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
This is a business.
So we have... Okay, so we're going to play as a husband and wife.
Okay.
That is, I'm going to leave you.
Okay.
Okay? We have met our match. We're done. This out. You think of a line, and I'm going to think of a line. So I'm going to go first, okay?
Is this comical or is this dramatic?
This is dramatic.
Oh, because I had a stupid line I was going to start with, too. Okay.
You let me know when you're ready. I have no practice on this, so I'm just going to... Yeah,
she wants to ad lib with me. That's
yes,
that
I
want to
ad lib with you.
That's funny. Okay. So you think leaving is going to remedy all the problems that I know that you have? Not to mention the fact I made you.
You did not make me.
How do you figure? You came from this little small town in Arkansas. I found you when nobody was even thinking about you, including your own mother.
Don't you dare bring my mom into this. I have never, ever brought your mom into our situation.
That's
and
because
we will
my
not
mom
do it
has
today.
Me in the right frame of mind. You still don't get it. You are a product of your mother.
Palmer,
that's why your
no.
mother left your
I will
father.
Never, see, this is why I'm leaving right now, because you never give me the respect and that I deserve.
Respect is earned.
And I've earned it.
Oh,
I've
really?
Worked 18 years is a long time.
Okay, so I'm supposed to respect the very woman that we don't even know who our child's father is, whether it's me or Wade?
You know it is you. It is you. He looks like you. He walks and talks like you.
But he is amazingly shorter than me.
Some type of
no, right, right.
That guy, I
goodness. No.
In that foul.
That's how you end the scene, right?
That's it.
That was great. That was so awesome.
Please forgive me. Just forgive me.
That was awesome. That was great.
Boy, in the fifth grade with a full mustache.
That is awesome. Why is that boy always running
with milk and cookies to the mailbox?
I love it. So let's get into Floyd right quick.
Six pack by the mailbox.
Let's get into Floyd right quick, because Floyd plays in a lot of shows that you're in. So is he kind of like Palmer Williams? Are y'all kind of tit for tat?
It's not even an alter ego. It's a lot of just Palmer seeping out.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the things that I can kind of say about Floyd is that it's my inner silly. Mm-hmm. My children would tell you that I'm not that silly. And they may even tell you that I'm not that funny. But what it is that it's almost like I'm revisiting some of the things of my childhood, but yet sarcastic. I am a bit sarcastic at times, and I have to be careful with that because it is a weapon. And it can be a weapon of mass destruction that you can hide. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? But the thing about it is I look like my character. It's not a caricature. That's probably the difference in why people recognize me on the street a little bit more, because, and those that know me personally know that there's a lot of Palmer and Floyd, a lot of Floyd and Palmer. They're pretty much one and the same. I'm just not like that silly all the time. Pretty kind of laid back, kind of calm. I don't like raising my voice. I'm not very argumentative. You tell me 2 + 2 = 5, I'm saying you're absolutely right. That's that new math. You know what I'm saying? We're going to go with that. Especially if you're paying me. You know, we're going to go with your math, you know. So, because I'm just not combative. I've gotten to a point in an area of maturity that it's wasted energy to fight. Especially if it's something that you know you're right about. Sometimes you have to let people go ahead and so-called win that argument, but you'll win the war.
Yeah.
So you just let them go about, just like, you know, with that skit.
Yeah.
You want to be argumentative with me? I was like, really? You're going to talk about my mom? Let's not even get on my mom. Let's talk about your mom. And just me just mentioning something that you're probably, and it's one thing, like a friend of mine told me, he's like, how is it when you're trying to beat yourself out of your child?
Yeah. Wow.
So, you know, you have to understand that if you see that happening, you have to kind of sit back. And then there have been times, like even in my prayer life, I've said, I'm sorry to my mother and father for the times that I may have hurt them because I was out of my mind.
Yeah.
And I wasn't really that bad of a kid. You know, my sisters may beg to differ, but, you know, and my brother, but I was a product of someone that lost their mother at 8 years old and had seen death very early and didn't understand why my mother had to go. And so I was kind of like all over the place emotionally and was mad at God for a long period of time until I realized that it was not his fault that she may have been sick or that he loved her first. So how am I going to be selfish with her?
Yeah.
You know, because she's his.
Exactly.
Even though I may have come through her, and he chose her for me to come through into this earthly realm. But, you know, you can't be mad at somebody when they actually, that's their person.
Yeah.
So I had to come to that realization. And Floyd and Palmer, like I said, you know, when I want to really have a good time, and that's my high. Making people laugh is when I get high. I really do. I mean, I don't have to do weed. I really don't. And because if I smoke joints, oh my God.
We don't want to see
did
that.
Did I say joints? Is it blunts now?
Yes,
is that
blunts.
Look, why did I turn to Wade to ask him, is it blunts? You know, like he's so into it, it's blunts, right? Or is it just CBD oil? You know. So it was one of those things where laughter, making people laugh is my addiction.
It
literally is my addiction. So if there's someplace I need to be sent off because of that, when they used to call it the loony farm, then definitely.
Yeah.
Loony. Yeah, I definitely would be prime candidate to be a patient there.
Yeah, I definitely love to laugh. And when I watch Floyd definitely makes me laugh. And thank you for that, because I'm cracking up, leaning over, stomach hurting at home laughing. My son is a huge fan.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, he definitely
had to send him a picture.
Yeah. In my Facebook right there and say, "What's up, KJ?"
What's up, KJ? That's funny. He's an hour behind, right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, so he gets to play Fortnite a little bit longer before you discover it, huh?
Yeah.
That Fortnite is a demon.
It
anyway,
is.
Anyway,
we don't even want to get onto that because I'm screaming and tapping on the wall.
Well, it's rewiring their brains to where it takes away your attention span.
KJ, are you listening to Palmer?
Yeah, because I tell my own teenage sons the same thing. So what happens is that it's a product of the devil in a sense. Because because it takes you away from, like, if I sit up there and you're doing all this rapid eye movement, you're doing all this right here, and you're wondering why you can't sleep at night. It's because your mind is wound up so tight because of these rapid eye movements. REM sleep is when your eyes are fluttering, usually when you're asleep, because your mind is at its highest brain activity.
Yeah.
Well, if you never give your brain an opportunity to rest, it's going to always be at REM. It's going to exhaust your brain. It's going to exhaust your capabilities to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to rewire your brain to where you cannot pay attention to things if you're talking slowly.
Right.
So when you go in the classroom, what's going to happen?
KJ,
when someone's trying to instruct
listening?
You, you can't listen. Your attention span is very short because you're used to this rapid eye movement. Not only that, you have the stimulus in your eyes, your brain, also your auditory. You're talking to somebody on a headset. So you got all of these stimuli going in. Right. And you wonder why you can't sleep.
Yeah. And also can't see because he just went to the eye doctor yesterday.
Oh, wow. I'm sorry, KJ. I didn't mean it. I didn't mean to bring it up. Your mama brought it up. Your mama brought it up.
Mom did. So we're talking about characters that you play in movies with. So how, and this is another one that my son also loved to death, is Patrice Lovely.
Oh, yeah. Hattie.
Yes, Miss Hattie. Yeah. He is a huge fan of hers,
too.
Yeah,
we're both from Alabama. A lot of people don't realize she's originally from Alabama.
So is she your favorite person to work with,
to bounce off of? Especially we've had a lot of fun of going back and forth. We were in a play a long time ago when she first kind of came over from Alabama and started she was nurturing that whole character of Hattie, and we had a lot of fun with that character. It was almost like we were the two elder statesmen of the show, so we had to kind of like carry the show. So it was a lot of fun developing those characters because I wasn't Floyd then. I was like Jasper. That was one of the characters that played Reverend Jasper, which is a reformed alcoholic turned preacher. So that was another whole entity there. And just I had also had a stint with her after that with the Universal Circus because she was like the first female ringmaster in the world.
Wow.
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize that. Before Ringling Brothers and all that.
Wow.
And so they had actually invited me out to take the place of Shucky Ducky for a while because he had not been on the show. I did 2 weeks of the circus. That's a hard life. I don't even know why people run away to the circus, but I ran away from the circus. You understand what I'm saying?
So, I don't blame you.
But it was a very good experience. And, she was there and we worked side by side again. So it was another experience, and then came full circle to where we ended up working on Love Thy Neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
So, we've been working together off and on for about 30 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a long time.
Yeah, it is. It's a long time. And then so that way we know what the other one's going to do.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we're able to work together well. Because we know what the other one's going to do, so we anticipate it. And so we know what to give them, and we know what they're going to give back. It's a chess. It's like playing chess with yourself, because you're going to end up winning anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's not an opposition. It's a collective thing. You both are winning
at
the same time.
Yeah,
because
that.
You're playing with yourself. You're almost mirror imaging each other.
That's awesome. So yeah. I don't have too many questions more for you. So what has been the biggest challenge for you in producing, acting, and all of that?
Loyalty and trust. This business is supposed to be based on those two things,
mm-hmm.
and also on business. And for some reason or another, there has been a lack thereof. Another challenge is to get out content that is powerful enough to change the world, as well as change the mindsets of different, you know, groups of people. Another challenge is that I'm not seeing enough content that's positive for the African American community, mm-hmm. and for the Black, Brown, and Beige community.
Yeah,
I think that needs to be stepped up. I think we need to buy more into it. That's another Black business to support.
Yeah, exactly.
But like I was telling my son and a group of gentlemen that are Morehouse seniors that visited the house this morning that are going to collab with my son, so you'll be seeing something from them soon. And that just started because one of the kids, James Smart Jr., his father was my first manager when I moved to Atlanta. So now we have the opportunity for our sons to embark upon entertainment.
Wow.
Here it is.
That's awesome.
You know, so many years later.
Yeah.
Both of them being 18 and 20 years old. So that was just like remarkable this morning to put them together for them to network, because my son's going to Georgia State and they're in Morehouse down the street. So, but they have this, their YouTube channel is Kale and P, and my son's is Palmer Williams 3. And so they actually are contemplating doing a movie together.
Wow.
So with their dads being in the industry and the influences and the connections that we have, you know, here it is, these kids under 22 years old,
mm-hmm.
about to embark upon making their first motion picture.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And so this is changing, you know, the understanding of what the Black story is. So it's exciting, it's encouraging,
mm-hmm.
because now it's coming from the youth and they have a voice. Unfortunately, they don't have anyone that's really leading them right now.
Mm-hmm.
And those that are leading, you know, may have a storied past, or they may not have enough experience in this movement. But at the same time, somebody will rise from these ashes of these burnings.
Mm-hmm.
And prayerfully, it'll be somebody that has the sense to go back and ask the elders what to do.
Exactly.
You know, ask, the former mayors, present mayors, civil rights leaders, you know, ask those people that have actually been in the struggle for things that are, even when the prevalence of killing Black men and women was even more frequent than it is now.
Yeah.
Especially when we're right here on the day after someone just got killed by Atlanta Police Department last night.
Yeah.
You know, and actually literally being shot in the back. I don't have all the details, but my understanding is that they fell asleep in a Wendy's mm-hmm. drive-thru.
Yeah.
I don't know that that's a crime. That's worthy of
Wayne
death.
Wayne was actually just talking about that earlier.
That's unfathomable. I can't even imagine, you know, something like that happening. And then my understanding is that I think there were kids present.
Oh, wow.
You know, so I know that we all probably have had an unhealthy fear of the police since mm-hmm. childhood, whether it be merited or not, you know, depending upon whatever the circumstance was for our parents or our relatives. But we got to get to a point where human lives, you know, is so much more valuable. And we got to stop being offensive to one another, because it is Black Lives Matter. It's not all lives matter. We know that. That's a given.
Yeah.
But we're the ones that every time we step out our door, we have to say goodbye to our loved ones, not knowing if we'll see them again.
Exactly.
What kind of life is that to live?
It's not.
You know, you got to worry about your 17-year-old son just if he go into school.
Yeah.
That's craziness. Nobody sends their child off to school to die. That's craziness.
That
school
craziness.
Shootings and all this. You live by the sword, you die by the sword. you know, and the sword in this case being the guns. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's got to be a time where, I mean, to all the cops out there that are shooting instead of just running somebody down, run behind them, get in shape. Mm-hmm. Stop shooting us. That, I mean, it sounds comical, but at the same time, it's like, when was there ever a time when you just shoot instead of just trying to apprehend somebody? Don't, if you don't want to run, don't be a cop.
Exactly.
If you don't want to do the work, don't be a cop. Everybody's not worthy of being shot in the back. That's just, I mean, I don't even want to go into that because I'll get fired up about it. I know it's supposed to be a very pleasant show.
No, we're fine.
But you know what? Sometimes we may have, you know, you can't be angry all the time, mm-hmm. but at the same time, if you got to offer some hope. And these young men today helped me to see that we're going to be okay if we lead them and guide them in the right way. They have to be able to listen, though.
Yeah.
And then also along with my son and the rest of my children as well. They have to be able to listen. And listen and not take the attitude that we're just trying to tell you something. Just listen to us. And then let's have a dialogue. Tell me how you feel, too.
Yeah.
You know, because sometimes, you know, we get cantankerous and in our old ways or whatever, and we don't want to listen. We're becoming our parents. Mm-hmm. No, I think I'm at that age where I'm becoming my parent, I'm becoming my father. And so you may have already started experiencing that as well.
I
so we have to get to a point where we have to also listen, too, even though we don't want to listen to them.
Yeah.
But they also have to still remember and respect the fact that you are the parent.
Exactly.
Never forget that because, you know, honor thy mother and thy father and thy days shall be long. And that comes with the knowledge that you can gain from your parents. And it doesn't mean that if you go up against me, you buck up against me, I'm going to kill you. That's what some black parents probably have kind of pushed to their children. But what it is that God watches your respect level for your parents. I'll leave that right there.
Yeah. That was so good. I like that.
It's,
Thank you for the knowledge here and wisdom as well. So this is...
just continue to live.
Yeah.
All of it will come. Just continue. Knowledge. Knowledge sometimes. Yeah. This is, you know, and I never have said this about myself. This is wisdom. I realize it now.
When
I look back at my father. My father was my first principal and my mother was my first grade teacher and librarian.
Wow.
And we lived on the Presbyterian Church School campus. So, you know, that's the upbringing I have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's my that legacy. I'm their legacy. You know, you see people talking about I'm my ancestors' wildest dreams. I'm my parents' wildest dreams.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But I also have a community of Camden, Alabama to represent. You know, the world may not think as much, but that's where I cut my teeth. That's where I grew up in Mobile, Alabama. That's where I cut my teeth some more and grew up there and had a family structure that loved me enough to push me into
mm-hmm.
what it is I'm supposed to be now. Because I don't even think I'm 30% to 40% of where I'm going to be.
Wow.
So then now I go on to Knoxville, Tennessee and go to college and get nurtured again by another mother figure like Miss Ruth Stokes and Miss Dunwoody and Dr. Donaldson and all of these women that imparted in my life as well as some of the men like in my fraternity. All my fraternity brothers and the alumni and everything from Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated, Beta Phi Chapter, Knoxville College, Spring 84 at 8:03 p.m., life member since 92. But anyway, so all of that nurturing. And then even I'm in an alumni association now where I have older brothers that are imparting wisdom in me just by their mere presence.
Wow.
So be a sponge. If I had to any advice to anybody, especially for actors, up and coming, camera persons, personalities, anything like that, be a sponge. Be a sponge. Absorb as much as you can. Don't always be quick to speak. Listen. Listen. How can you learn if you can't hear over your own self talking? So if you don't know, seek the knowledge. And there's always this thing about if you want a black person not to know anything, put it in a book. Because mm-hmm. they'll never read it.
Yeah.
Same thing with instructions. So don't be that stereotypical person. If you want to defeat the oppressor, learn. Wisdom. Education. That's why they keep rising the price of it, because they don't want you to get it.
Exactly.
People used to get beat for learning how to read. And yet and still, you won't get your work done in school Are you serious? KJ. And then paying for it?
Yeah.
Do you realize what you could do? Does your son go to private school?
No.
Okay. If he did, could you imagine how much money you would have invested thus far?
Oh, yeah.
And how upset you would have been for all the work that you've done and invested in their future.
Exactly.
We're doing this for you. We're not doing it just because we want to get you out the house.
Yeah.
We had you because we wanted you. That's another whole thing.
Yeah.
So get the wisdom. Fight them at the polls. And the biggest thing, the thing that I feel killed most of our civil rights leaders that were slain and assassinated, economic empowerment. It's really, it's not about black and white, it's about green. Green and greed. If you get to a point where you're starting to economically empower yourselves, that's what gets their attention. When you stop spending money with them, that's what brought that rebel flag down.
Yeah.
When you stop spending money at Starbucks because you don't want them to wear anything from Black Lives Matter, now all of a sudden you letting everybody wear the paraphernalia.
Yeah.
It's all about the bottom line.
Yeah.
Why are you going to support? If your master, your massa, was selling some T-shirts for the Cross Plantation and you were free, would you really go back and just still buy them? Why would you do that? And support the very person that oppressed you.
Yeah.
And it wasn't that long ago. Well, would you buy it? Mm. So you're going to eat at the table of your enemy?
Wow.
The Lord has prepared a table in the presence of your enemies. But do you have to eat? Why would you eat from somebody that doesn't like you, but they want your money?
Exactly.
A smile on your face, yeah, all the while, want to take your place. Backstabbers. I went OJ's on you. But so this, it can get deeper and deeper, but
Dan,
just
wow,
start to buy black. And those that own these businesses give good quality service. And don't necessarily have to look like a black business. Just be a business that happens to be owned by a black person.
Right.
Make it general.
Yeah.
Unless it's black paraphernalia, of course, that makes sense. But just make it a business. Don't be a black business. Just be a business. Because you get that green. And then you go back and you start another black business with somebody else. The Vietnamese, the Koreans, the Indians, the Mexicans. Everybody else brings their family in, can live in one house, get along,
yeah,
and then send everybody out with different mm-hmm. businesses. And we can't do that. We always talk about how we're the first to do this. We're the Moors. We're the mothers and fathers of civilization. We're of royal descent. Step up and take your crown. Take your throne. How you do that? Empower yourselves. Anybody that has the audacity to set up a rally on June 19th in Tulsa, Oklahoma, that's an arrogant demon. And it wasn't until he came under fire that he decided to change it out of respect. If you had respect for it and you knew your history, you would have never done that.
Wow.
That's an arrogant devil.
Wow. You guys heard it right here on The Morning Jam, the evening edition with your sis and your friend Crystal Cole.
I'm going to lose all my white followers.
And
you know I love you.
William,
you know I love
right
you.
Here, you guys, speaking knowledge and truth.
And see, and I sound like, you know, some of the things that we don't know that are offensive. It's like, you know, because I have a few white friends.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, it's like, you know, I have two black friends. You know, but it's going to have to get to a point where they're just friends.
Yeah.
And be allies of one another. Don't be enemies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that now with all of this stuff that's going on, we need all those people that are the tough and the mighty and stuff like that and fighting the warriors out there in the street that are, we're having each other, you know, having these wars and stuff, step up and protect us now. You know, and I'm not necessarily saying anybody in particular, you know who it is, you know, protect us now. Protect us now. Protect us now. Anybody that's ever taken from the community, protect us now.
That's awesome. So let me clap my hand on that.
You're so funny. You're so
clap
funny.
My hand on that. So this that's is funny. The last thing. So let the people know where they can connect with you. They get right. A Holt of Palmer William.
Yeah, that's good in country. A Holt. I'm fixing to tell you.
Fixing to.
You can contact me at PalmerWilliamsJr.com, PalmerWilliamsJ on Instagram, PalmerWilliamsJ on Twitter, and PalmerWilliamsJr on Facebook. I cannot eliminate anybody off of Facebook, so you can be my friend, because all 11,000 people are my closest friends. So that sounds almost arrogant, but and I don't think of people as fans. They're friends of my journey.
That's awesome.
Because I don't have to pretend that I'm humble. It's just the way I was raised.
Mm-hmm.
And I know all this can be over with a twinkling of an eye. And so I'm grateful to God for everything that he is yet doing, seen and unseen, for my life and for those that are affected directly by me being the provider for their lives here on earth. You know, because whether people think about it this way or not, that job, that boss, that money you're making, none of those are your source. God is your source.
Exactly.
And as soon as you acknowledge that and know that, then everything else will follow suit.
You guys heard it again. Palmer Williams out here, he's speaking truth on everything. Yeah, every question I ask, he's speaking everything, knowledge and truth. So you guys can connect with me on Instagram, Snapchat, and Twitter. Also on Facebook, connect with me on www.crystala.cross@gmail.com. And we out of here. Peace.